Howdy folks, welcome to FoundFlix. On This Ending Explained, we'll be looking at the big screen adaptation of the beloved children's horror novel, Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark, where a group of teens stumble upon a book of stories tied to an infamous local town legend, and find the book has the power to bring its horrifying words to life with dangerous results. And it's up to the teens to face their fears in order to save their lives. If you're a fan of the books and read them as a child like myself, and are wondering if the movie version is worth seeing, I can absolutely say yes. What the movie version gets so perfect and spot on is bringing the horrific illustrations from the book to life in the real world. When I reread the books recently, I had forgotten how simple and short the actual stories are, usually only one or two pages each. But what really sticks with you, and in many cases adds much more horror to the stories, Stephen Gamel's abstract and extremely distinct illustrations, creating unforgettable creatures and nightmarish visions far beyond what the words convey. Clearly, director Andre Averdahl and producer Guillermo del Toro realize this is the real strength of the books, and bring these illustrations to life to perfection. You know what makes them work so well? They were adamant to use mostly practical effects, as in stunt performers and actors in suits, with some CG additions to really make the creatures feel alive. As del Toro said, 90% practical, 10% CG. And this combo just works so well in its execution. Along with some excellent production design and atmosphere, these creatures from the pages are just as frightening as what our imaginations would conjure when reading the stories. I did wonder how exactly they would adapt the extremely short stories into a full-length movie, and rather than a typical anthology with separate chapters, they bring each of the stories into a larger, overarching one, which I found to be a creative way to unify the stories together into a grander whole. However, the elements beyond the monsters' sometimes too brief appearances are less memorable, almost acting as the calm between the storm, or really filler before they introduce the next story, which makes the movie at times feel overlong and a little slow at points while we impatiently wait for the next nightmare to occur. It's really all about them, which is the most important aspect of the adaptation to get right, in my opinion anyway. So we'll be breaking down which stories and monsters are referenced in the movie, the complete story of the vengeful spirit at the heart of our story, and explaining the ending that really opens up things to a sequel. Our story unfolds in the turbulent, changing times of the late 60s, 1968, on the verge of Nixon becoming president and the beginning steps of civil rights. Yet, as we see, there is still plenty of casual racism to go around. Though the small town of Mill Valley feels far removed from these changing times, only glimpsed in the background of their lives. This aspect appears to be drawing comparisons to then and our current political climate with that Trump guy in charge, and a general feeling of unease in the country. I don't really know the necessity of this, as it's mostly window dressing and doesn't affect our characters too much, but it's definitely there. On Halloween night, a group of wisecracking oddball friends, taking a page out of Stranger Things or any other kid cast of the ilk, are growing up and meet up for their final Halloween hurrah together before getting too old for candy and costumes. Every year, local bully and all-around jerkass, Tommy pulls a prank on our group, but this time Chuck is ready for him. When Tommy spots them also on a date with Chuck's sister Ruth, the three egg his car, and Chuck unleashes the coup de grace, a flaming bag of dog poo that lands right in Tommy's lap, causing him to crash his car into a fence. Nice prank and all, but maybe should have thought about what to do after, as Tommy is pissed, chasing the kids with a baseball bat, who take cover in the car of a stranger at a drive-in, Ramon, providing them protection when Tommy comes by to threaten them. And a fast friendship grows between Ramon and the gang. And perhaps a little romance is in the air for Stella as well. And I'm not sure why, maybe to impress Ramon, and it is Halloween night after all, Stella suggests they go to investigate the infamous Bellows House, a grand abandoned estate, also home to the town's most famous urban legend, said to be where a young girl, Sarah, has slain several children, known for whispering scary stories to them through the walls before taking their lives, then writing their tales in a book with their blood. Cool, sounds fun, let's definitely check it out. They find the door locked up, but Ramon handily breaks in with a pin, and initially it doesn't appear that there's too much going on inside, old and musty and covered in cobwebs. That is until Chuck decides to try and scare Augie, hiding in an armoire and waiting patiently to spook his pal. He then hears a noise coming from outside, and shockingly when opening the door, the house looks back to its older, pristine, lived-in state, spotting an older woman and her dog who stare intently at him, yet just as quickly, they vanish. Chuck assuming he's just seeing things. Elsewhere in the house, Ramon and Stella stumble upon the mysterious Sarah's room, led there by a door hidden behind a shelf that takes them into a stark, lonely basement. There she finds her book of scary stories, and when flipping through the pages, does appear to not be written in your standard ink. The others join them in the basement, Chuck in particular ready to leave, which proves difficult when a still angry Tommy shows up, locking them down there along with Ruth.
That's pretty rude to do to your date, bud.
Stuck in the basement, they shout and scream to get out, and something surprising lends them a hand. Black swirls manifest, moving along the walls, and unlatch the door. This is essentially the spirit of Sarah herself, and each time we see the black swirls, we know that means she's utilizing her powers. Outside, they find Ramon's car has been vandalized by Tommy, and Stella offers him her couch in the basement. But she can't help but look at the book again. Flipping through the pages, we see references to many different stories from the original books, but she's confused when coming to a bunch of blank pages. Even more so when written words begin to appear, writing themselves on the page, telling the story of Harold, perhaps the most famous of the book's many haunting creations, and seeing Tommy's name appear as well. Meanwhile, Tommy, drunk off his ass, makes it home, and his none too pleased mother reminds him of some important egg delivery he forgot to do, sending him into the crop fields to do so. It's here that the scarecrow called Harold resides, a frightening doughy visage, missing most of his midsection. Tommy likes to beat it up and says that he hates it, but the reality appears that he is actually frightened of it. Yeah, well, who could blame him? That thing is pretty gnarly looking. And it's thanks to Sarah's story that brings Harold to life. First seen no longer on his regular stake, then appearing in the cornfields, lumbering after Tommy. He attempts to retaliate with a pitchfork, but the dude is made out of straw after all, and Harold turns the weapon instead on Tommy, jamming him in the gut, seeing that somehow there is straw in his wound. It only gets worse, as more straw begins to spring from his ears and top of his head, finally his mouth, vomiting out straw onto the ground, ultimately turning Tommy into the new Scarecrow, later seen wearing the same Letterman jacket he was that night. In the original, the beats are mostly the same, but instead it's two farmers who use their Scarecrow Harold to take out aggression on a farmer they dislike with that name. In the end, it still comes to life, and one of the farmers gets skinned alive. So quite a different in here than the original, but I actually quite like this new take on the story. And apparently they actually shot the skinning part but ended up cutting it out. Stella is disturbed by the story, but it's only a story, right? But she along with Ramon find out the hard way that isn't the case when finding Tommy's now scarecrowified body. Ah, well, no big loss. He was a chode anyway, but things get personal when the book and Sarah select their next target, their buddy Augie, who's home all alone. On the phone, he complains to his mom about the lack of food in the house, but luckily there is a mysterious pot of stew in the fridge waiting for him. His mom doesn't know who made it, but hey, it's there. Someone had to have, right? Well, it's Sarah that's cooking up something disgusting. You don't want to eat that stew, I promise. The others see another story starting to be written, The Big Toe, which was originally a folk tale about a young boy finding a toe and his family eating it, this time featuring a clueless Augie doing the same. See where this is going? They frantically call him and beg him to not eat anything. Meanwhile, he's just digging into some of that delicious stew, balking at what they're saying, and not really paying attention to what he's eating. He quickly gets a wake-up call when accidentally eating a toe, spitting it out in disgust and spilling the pot on the floor, spotting other delights like eyeballs and what have you in there as well. Mmm, them's good eats. Although the toe's owner isn't exactly delighted with Augie's eating habits. A croaky voice calling out to him, "Where is my toe?" And then the terrifying person it belongs to appears, a ghostly thin woman with open mouth and gangly limbs that proceeds to stalk him around the house, always groaning the same question about where her toe is. He takes cover under a bed, hearing her shambling footsteps outside. The door slowly creaks open, and Augie can barely contain his fright as she enters the room standing right in front of him. She appears to vanish until suddenly Augie is dragged into an expanded black void under the bed, digging his nails into the floor as he's dragged away into a dark oblivion. Once again, Stella and the rest are worried by the story they saw being written, and learn for sure they were dealing with a nefarious force when going back to Augie's and finding the only signs of him left, the scratch marks from his nails in the wood that stop at the wall. Similar to Tommy hating Harold the Scarecrow, Augie mentions that he was told the Big Toe folktale as a child and it always terrified him. So what we are seeing, as they say in the trailer, you don't read this book, it reads you! For each story bringing to life its respective victims' most deep-seated fears, and setting them free in our world. world. And it will be coming for each and every one that was in the house when Stella took the book on Halloween. She does attempt to return the book and even apologize to Sarah for taking it. Yet when she returns home, she finds Ramon reading the book. It returned to her house on its own. It's not done until it makes its way through all the kids. So they set out to learn more about Sarah and hopefully stop her before another story is written. Typically in your modern horror movie, everything you'd want to know about any ghoul or ghost is just one convenient Google search away. Not so much in the 1960s. You'd actually go to the library and look up microfiche and shit to even maybe find what you're looking for. Olden days. There they begin to uncover some of the backstory of the Bellows family, who settled in the town in the 1800s. They were an industrious family, bringing growth to the small town for many years, until one by one, the family members all disappeared without a trace. They see an article that references Sarah and having some kind of disability, and that she was eventually sent to a psychiatric hospital, with her own brother being her caretaker. There was tale of black voodoo magic being taught to her by two of the servants that worked at their, at the time, thriving estate. Well, there you have it, black magic. And according to Chuck, if it's in the paper, it's gotta be true. Another little subtle nod to today's impossible to trust news sources. Even with all their new uncovering of the family's history, they're unable to prevent Chuck's sister Ruth becoming her next story subject. Based on the original story, The Red Spot. Back at the house on Halloween, she got bitten by a spider. And ever since then, it's gotten bigger and bigger. Now on the night of her performance of the musical Bye Bye Birdie, it's growing to harrowing size. The other girls urging her to do something about that. Seeing a large whitehead in the mirror, Ruth cautiously pokes at it and then sees something moving under her skin. Ugh! She keeps kind of poking at it as from the apex of the boil, what looks like a leg pokes out of her face and begins to move when she gets close to touching it. The boil explodes, unleashing legions of spiders all over Ruth. But luckily Chuck and the rest of the kids show up in time to rescue her. Her face is definitely injured, but at least she's still alive thanks to our gang. They continue their search into Sarah's past, visiting one of the women who supposedly taught her that black magic. A young girl at the time, but now elderly Lulu. And she clarifies they didn't teach her anything, describing what she has as being pure rage that's responsible. It's extreme emotions that can keep a spirit in our world, and rage is a pretty standard and strong one in films. Her family already treated her like shit due to some mental health issues, though again it was believed she was a child killer, and they also do keep her in a locked room hidden behind a cabinet. So yeah, it makes sense that she's got some rage going on. Their next destination is the hospital where Sarah was taken for treatment, and according to legend, died. But Chuck has some reservations about venturing further. He's been having dreams after the first night at the house, and in the dream was told to avoid red rooms, an adaptation of the short story The Dream, and where they need to go, the research and development department, as in red, spooks him too much to go along with Ramon and Stella. Turns out he made the wrong choice, as once the hospital learns the kids snuck in, go into alarm mode, and all the lights in the hospital switch from white to a haunting red, effectively making everywhere a red room, which is not good for Chuck, as the pale lady manifests for his story. This one they do such a perfect job making real because it's just so damn weird looking. With that big old creepy smile and everything, just really well done execution wise. Guess why? Like I said, 90% practical, that's why CG ain't scary. The pale lady ain't exactly quick on her feet. However, every corridor Chuck turns down, there she is, waiting for him, until one appears in each hall around him, blocking him in with no way out. They converge upon him, and she absorbs Chuck into her body until he merges with her into one. Yep, super weird, me likey. Down in the hospital archives, Ramon and Stella discover that everything they thought they knew about Sarah was a lie, stumbling upon an old wax cylinder. They play it, hearing recording of Sarah and her doctor brother in a therapy session. He keeps pressing her to say that she killed the children, and when she doesn't respond how he wants, they dose her with a healthy shock of electricity, eventually breaking her down until she finally relents to say that she was responsible, which we now know is not the truth. Her family was forcing her to admit guilt. But why? Money, of course. We already know that her family was prosperous with their fancy paper mills and whatnot, but when it came to the children that must have all died in mysterious circumstances, this is actually due to mercury from their plants seeping into the water supply. And this was actually what was responsible for the children's deaths in town. Yet, if word were to get out about the Bellows family being involved, it would doom their many businesses. So they frame their distraught family member Sarah for their own crimes, covering it up with extraordinary tales of black magic. And with Sarah disposed of, they could get back to business and get away away scot-free. Well, not so much, as the rage-filled Sarah returned as a vengeful spirit, and one by one took out the members of her family, until there was no one left. Each got their own respective stories and creatures, with her father being taken by the Wendigo, another popular legend included in the books. But before they can hatch any kind of plan, the pair are placed under arrest for breaking into the hospital, which allows Sarah to write Ramon's scary story, that of the Jangly Man, a frightening mishmash of parts, walking on all fours like an animal, which combines a few different stories from the books. The assembling of pieces from What Do You Come For?, where a woman asks for some company, only for various body parts to fall from her fireplace and put themselves together, along with Me Tai Doti Walker, which the creature utters repeatedly, based on a traditional American folktale, though the design of the Jangly Man himself is entirely new for the film. And overall, I do like what they're going for here, especially with how he moves, again performed by an actual contortionist actor, which makes all the difference. For Ramon, his story ties to his brother, who told him the same story when they were young, and later his brother was enlisted for the Vietnam War and died. And now Ramon has been drafted, though due to fear of dying himself as well as from losing his brother, this caused him to dodge the draft instead. That's your fear. Just as in the book, the Jangly Man appears piece by piece, plopping out of a fireplace. Kind of weird to have a fireplace at a police station. I don't know, maybe that's normal in Pennsylvania. All witnessed by his dog. These details straight out of the book, though the dog flees in terror rather than dying from it as in the original. Mr. Jangly snaps the sheriff's neck before turning on the kids, but they manage to grab his keys and escape. Ramon knows the monster is only after him, giving Stella a distraction to book it back to the Bellows house for a final confrontation with Sarah's spirit, though she winds up getting transported to her own story, the haunted house, which the overarching story of the movie has been a loose adaptation of, where a preacher visits a haunted house, encountering the ghost of a dead 20-year-old, helping her to find her killer and bury her bones to put her soul to rest. Pretty much the same as what's going on here. And the book image actually bears striking resemblance to their version of the big toe monster with missing eyes and everything. Stella finds herself back in the livelier days at the Bellows Manor, where unfortunately for her, the family believes that she is Sarah, getting caught by them and tossed down into her dingy basement room with no remorse. She attempts to appeal to the restless spirit, offering to tell Sarah's story. Not what the public has been led to believe, but the truth. Sarah manifests as a physical spirit, fluctuating between a blue-faced woman and a more frightening skeletal appearance, and she agrees to let Stella tell her story by writing it in the book, but needs a particular kind of ink, as we know, getting Stella to prick her finger on a pen for ink, and she frantically begins to scrawl the truth into the book's pages. Now that the truth has been told, Sarah's spirit is finally at rest, and Stella goes on to publish her story on a wider scale. Now the whole world knows the truth about what was really going on at the Bellows household all those years ago, though she left out the part about the evil book and everything, but yeah, that makes sense. In the end, Ramon has overcome his fears of going to war, seen taking a bus out of town to go do his duty for his country. It is Vietnam, which was a total clusterfuck, but that's okay, it doesn't matter. While Stella and her father leave too, but she has a new mission going forward that sets us up nicely for a sequel. She still has the book in her possession and believes that all of her friends can be brought back in some way via the book, vowing to do whatever she can to bring them back. This is definitely possible, as each of the characters that are taken aren't specifically killed, just whisked away in some manner, whether pulled into darkness like Augie or absorbed by the pale woman like Chuck. Presumably, they are now, in a sense, trapped in the book's pages, and a sequel could explore this being a possibility. A direction that could be interesting is to have Stella begin to write stories of her own, as she did in the climax, and by writing with her blood in the books, could craft new stories that bring her friends back to our world with the power of the book, which can change reality in addition to creating monsters and everything else. This wouldn't be too out of the realm of possibilities based on what's already been established about the book, and would be a cool way to kind of mutate the original concept into a new direction. Hopefully this one does well enough to warrant a sequel, because I'd love to see this creative team sink their teeth into bringing more of these classic creatures and stories to life. This brings us to the conclusion of this ending explain on scary stories to tell in the dark. While not the scariest movie ever made by any stretch, that's not really the intention here. It's more designed to be a gateway horror film for kids, and it did strike that balance very well of being scary but not too scary to permanently scar young viewers. I kept being reminded of Annabelle Comes Home, which somehow was rated R, yet had no real gore or anything like that to speak of. Yet this PG-13 movie managed to actually push the envelope and develop some good scares and gore as well. In addition to having actual stakes, something you might remember I complained about in that movie, since our kids are actually in legitimate danger. In the sense of what I look for in a horror movie, Scary Stories is far superior in pretty much every way. Andre Guillermo and the rest of the team did an admirable job adapting the beloved books into exactly what they should be for the big screen. Nice job, guys. But yeah, maybe work on the characters a little more if we do get a sequel. Just a suggestion. What did you guys think of Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark? Which story is your favorite? And which would you like to see in a potential sequel? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Make sure to like, subscribe, and follow. Thanks for watching FoundFlix. See you next time.